Micro Lecture 20, Industrialization in Europe and the World. The industrialization process that first happened in England quickly replicated in many other parts of the world. Once the Napoleonic Wars end, many countries in the continent began to mobilize resources to catch up with the British. They were able to achieve their own pattern of technological innovation and economic growth. By the end of the 19th century, most European countries, the United States and Japan, had industrialized their economies and were already competing with the British. Industrialization in other parts of the world was a more complicated process. Many historians continue to discuss the reasons for this type of economic backwardness. Despite the debates, what is certain is that non-Western countries had more difficulties developing the material conditions that allowed them to have a robust industrialization and economic development. In the European case, Belgium successfully adopted the British model and experienced a significant increase in technology and industrial growth between 1830 and 1860. France had a slower development during the first couple of years of European industrialization. Germany's rise was spectacular, and its growth has been often described as the beginning of the Second Industrial Revolution. Despite the many disadvantages that continental Europe had compared to Britain, especially the lack of enough coal, European nations had many advantages in their industrialization process. Most of these countries had a rich tradition of creating enterprises and promoting merchant capitalism. They also had artisans and skilled urban traders that quickly incorporated into the workforce and the new market conditions. The second significant advantage is that continental capitalists did not have to develop their technology since they could get it from Great Britain. Finally, most of these countries had strong and centralized governments willing to invest capital and resources in catching up with Great Britain. The British tried to do everything they could to prevent the popularization of its technologies in continental Europe. Logically, they want to have a monopoly over their inventions and took measures to keep that control. For example, until 1825, it was illegal for artisans and skilled mechanics to leave Britain, and until 1843, the export of machinery was forbidden. However, these agents of industrialization moved abroad looking for better opportunities. Other important industrialization agents were entrepreneurs willing to invest money on private enterprises and national governments that implement tariffs to protect national industries. After 1815, continental governments also invest in building roads, canals, and railroads to improve transportation and reduce costs. Bankers were the last type of industrialization agents who promote industrialization in the continent. Starting in Belgium, these institutions began to mobilize massive resources investing in big companies. They then became industrial banks and successfully promoted industrial development. In the case of the United States, the industrialization process was quick and effective. Still discussed today, the industrialization of the northern part of the country happened first, while in the south, the capitalist conditions to have a robust industrial economy took longer. In Asia, for most of the 19th century, China and India stagnate. At the same time, Japan, after its forced opening to the world in 1850, quickly adopted Western technology and manufacturing methods that triggered the country's industrialization and economic growth. In Russia, the imperial government tried to promote industrialization by importing steam ships to transit the Volga River. They also invested in railroads to connect the capital, St. Petersburg, with the rest of the country. Cotton factories were also found, but all the efforts were vain, and the country entered the world economy as a raw material provider. In the Ottoman Empire, similar projects were put in place, but the policies to promote industrialism failed in many of its territories. For example, despite all efforts, Egypt fell back and became a supplier of raw materials. In India, the Industrial Revolution made millions of people lose their jobs. The local textiles workers couldn't compete with the British industries and went bankrupt. With the arrival of railroads in the mid-19th century, the country became an agricultural powerhouse, and industrialization only made a significant impact many years later. China did not adopt mechanized production until the end of the 19th century, but continued as a market-based commercial society with a massive rural sector for many years after. In Latin America, after the Wars of Independence, the economy and the infrastructure were destroyed entirely. As these countries tried to recover during the mid-19th century, all the money and the infrastructure was used to develop an agro-export economy that put down domestic industrial production for decades. The rise of industrialization in Europe, Great Britain, Japan, and the United States was extremely beneficial. Still, it caused other regions of the world to become increasingly dependent on their export economies. Instead of industrializing, many of these territories had to deindustrialize to survive. They entered the world system only as suppliers of raw materials. This is all I have for you today. Thank you, and I'll see you next time.